Michelangelo is one of the most renowned artists in history. His work covers the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel, and who does not know of Michelangelo's Pietà or his statue of David? A true Renaissance man, he was a sculptor, painter, poet, and architect. His works have inspired generations, leaving a legacy which has influenced the course of Western art. But what lies beyond the fame? We'll find out all in this episode of Catholic Focus as we explore the struggle and the creative process that made Michelangelo a master. Hello and welcome to Catholic Focus. I'm Cheridan Sanders. I'm pleased to welcome to our Salt and Light studios Lloyd DeWitt. He's the Curator of European Art at the Art Gallery of Ontario, and he's here to speak to us about their latest exhibit, Michelangelo Quest for Genius. Thanks for speaking with us today.
My pleasure.
So tell us how this exhibit came to be.
We've been talking to the Casa Buonarroti for about 15 years. We've always wanted an exhibit by Michelangelo, I think a very famous artist and someone who's struggles for perfection have captivated visitors to the Vatican and to Italy for centuries, of course. We've never managed to come to the right situation until now, so we're really thrilled to finally bring a group of drawings from the Casa Buonarroti to Toronto, to a brand new audience. We've never had a Michelangelo exhibition in Toronto before. So
many people think that genius is effortless, but when we're going through your exhibit, mm-hmm. It's clear that Michelangelo struggled. He had unfinished works. There was a lot of disappointment. He worked tirelessly. Why was it so important to you to show this?
Well, it's true. People go to the Sistine ceiling. It all looks graceful and elegant. You don't see the work behind the finished product, but in fact the drawings show you the working process. They show you the agony of working through many, many different solutions, of discarding and struggling with many different solutions and trying to come to a kind of perfect solution and trying to meet deadlines as well and trying to make patrons happy. All of that shows up on the works on paper. It doesn't really show up in the finished product very much at all. Although Michelangelo is famous for being the artist of the unfinished, who did leave portions of his work incomplete, and that started to develop a very strong meaning for Michelangelo. It was the struggle to deal with his own limitations as an artist to achieve these very high ideals of perfection that he set for himself.
So set the stage for us. Where do we find ourselves at the time of Michelangelo? What are what's the politics? What's the social situation, economics?
Rome is growing as a city, and Florence is tremendously wealthy at this time. And you have warring states, but you have the growth of an economic system that is very consistent, and you have the growth of wealth and trade in Italy and throughout Europe. And that matters because it enables patrons to consistently be able to work on long-term projects and to build churches and also palaces and to support artists, and that really requires a lot of stability and a lot of wealth. And I think that growth is really what sets the stage for the Renaissance in Florence, and that's where Michelangelo steps in.
Okay, so tell us about the exhibit. How is it set up?
It's organized into four distinct categories that look at the question of genius, and they look at it not from the point of view of it being something that's easy or distant, but rather something that we can all relate to. The idea that aspects of genius are really struggles that we all deal with on a daily basis. And also look at what sets these individuals of high creativity apart, the ambition. We notice that artists like Michelangelo set goals for themselves that are far in excess of what their contemporaries produce. They want to take on all of history. They want to outdo everyone around them. They're enormous ambition, and they have enormous self-confidence, and that really sets them apart. But they're also immensely productive. They have many more hits, because they have many more misses too, and that's also something that sets them apart. So we looked at the idea of genius from many different angles, spiritual, also psychological, from the world of science. So a lot of people are looking at the role of failure in success, and they notice that the struggles against to overcome disappointment and how certain individuals deal with that really makes an enormous difference. And they notice that these types are very these people are very persistent. They tend to keep going and push through where a lot of other people would stop and would concede failure. They have a very special way of dealing with frustration, that they turn it into something very special. It's actually often instrumental to the finest works of art, that there's some core of burning through and pushing through a barrier. And the Sistine Ceiling, for instance, is certainly like that. Even the sculpture of David. Unfortunately, we can't move those to Canada, but we're glad to show you something even more special, which is Michelangelo's private life, his private musings, his private struggle. You got to remember, these drawings were not intended for public consumption. Michelangelo did not intend for you to look at these drawings, these sketches. So we get to watch something really unique here. We see a lot of unfinished projects, and that's also great. You see these in the drawings, they don't exist in the real world at all, but they contain some of his greatest and most influential innovations. His students saw them, they carried on the tradition. Those who were influential in the field of architecture, for instance, were immensely aware of the things that Michelangelo had wanted to do but was never able to do. And you can see those too in this exhibit, because these were done in the field of drawing.
And speaking of architecture, he said that someone who doesn't understand the human body can never understand architecture. What was behind that?
Michelangelo didn't slavishly imitate nature, but he said he took his inspiration from nature. And you see, one tiny little drawing of a human head that is then altered. You can see that he's using the proportions of the human head to create a cornice. He constantly drew column bases that you can see are based on human proportions. So the human body for him was the standard that architecture had to be based on. The human body was the standard for many things for him, the standard of beauty, but also for architecture. So it's a peculiar concept for us, but the proportions, the ideal proportions that he looked for, he often found those in the human body.
And I understand that he also dissected several cadavers, human and animal. What was behind that?
He was one of the very first artists to do this. It was, of course, strictly forbidden to violate the dead human bodies. But he saw a higher purpose in examining the structure of the human body. And this is what he became obsessed with, and this is what you see in the drawings and in the greatest sculpture, an understanding of the mechanics of the human body, how it moved, where mass and volume really occurred because of the workings of the muscles. And that curiosity is also, of course, one of the key attributes of genius, is the burning desire to continually push and know and learn more.
Another thing that I noticed when I was doing some research on him is that he burnt a lot of his drawings.
He did.
Why?
I know. When you see these precious drawings, it makes you ache for what we've lost. But alas, there was no such thing as copyright back then. So in order to protect his inventions, he had to carefully control what happened to the drawings, which were his thinking put on paper. He may also have been trying to edit himself a bit to show not as much of the struggle as he thought we ought to see, but there were a lot of factors that led him to order his drawings to be burned and destroyed. So 600 left, but we know he must have drawn every day. That would not be very many drawings because he had such a long, long career. But there must have been thousands of drawings, so we have just a small fraction. What's especially painful is that he burned these cartoons, and the cartoons are the large, full-scale drawings that were placed on the plaster to transfer the design to the wall that they'd be painted on. And this, of course, is the Sistine Chapel, but also the Battle of Cascina, another great fresco project that he undertook. Must have involved acres of paper and drawings for some of the most marvelous inventions that we're familiar with, like the creation of Adam in the Sistine. And all those drawings are gone and deliberately destroyed because he needed to protect his inventions.
Mm-hmm. There's also a sense of great intimacy with anyone mm-hmm. he did actually share his drawings with, some of his patrons and of course people who are very close to him. Can you share some insight on that?
The field of collecting drawings is really in its infancy at this point. Drawings weren't really thought of as independent works of art, and yet we notice that Michelangelo does do some drawings as independent works of art, and other artists did this too. But for the most part, drawings were meant as tools of the trade, and they were kept private and very closely controlled. Their traffic was closely controlled. So that when you do see the odd finished drawing, it's almost always a gift. And that gift, this exchange, is very intimate. I mean, we know that he gave drawings to Tommaso Cavaliere, his very close friend, and that these drawings show his idealism. He carefully works them so that all trace of his hand is effaced, so that they're polished and they look otherworldly. They achieve that kind of perfection that is his obsession, of course, his standard of beauty. That had great meaning for him, and that's what he communicated in these drawings. But there are only a few of them, these divine heads, as collectors called them afterwards. And they stand out in his work as something that's especially precious to him, but also something that's done with his own hand and something that can be given as a small token of friendship.
Can you give me a sketch of who Michelangelo was or what we can actually know of him from these drawings?
We know a lot about him from his drawings. We know he was very instrumental. He did not sit there and invent flying machines, for instance, or see faces in clouds. He was always drawing for the purpose of inventing something that he needed. Now, not everything got used. There were a lot of problems that he's solving in his mind that never ended up being used for a final work of art. But the drawings always serve that purpose. They're always aimed at solving some artistic problems. So they're very functional drawings, and you get a sense of everyday life and his own practice that he's grabbing for whatever's close at hand. He sketches a gorgeous niche on the back of a letter. He scribbles designs for the Laurentian Library staircase on his students' drawings, and then cuts out the edge to make a template for a column base. So you have a sense of manic energy, of inventiveness that's just overflowing, that's effulgent. And this is from someone who others described as being quite melancholic. So you have a sense of a very complicated and difficult personality. He was also referred to as being terrible or a terror. You know, his personality is called his terribilità, which can mean something very good as well, but for the most part it didn't. But people recognize it as kind of a creative fury. And you see that aspect of incessant creativity on these sheets, and I think that's just marvelous. Other drawings are beautiful compositions in their own right, like the head of Leda, for instance, and the drawing of the niche. There are drawings for the Sistine ceiling, the beautiful head from the flood, for instance, I think is its own very composed image. But for the most part, the intensity is what you really get a very good sense of.
In terms of technological innovation, how did Michelangelo view the new mediums of the day? Obviously, paper was a new mm-hmm. medium, and his relationship with other types of technological innovations.
Michelangelo is surprisingly someone who thought as a sculptor, not necessarily as an inventor, the way Leonardo was. So we don't have very many notebooks by Michelangelo. He's always in the studio, and the paper is always around him. He's not traveling around and taking little notes and musings off in some palazzo. He's a real worker. Paper had become a lot cheaper. It's something that came from the East, of course, and it made the production of paper in Italy using linen and these wonderful mesh frames meant that artists could compose and think about their artistic inventions much more freely than before. Before, you had designs drawn on parchment that were very precious, that were often handed from one workshop to the next, from a master to his pupil. They were inherited because they were so rare, and the basic material of designing was so precious. Now you have a lot of freedom. You can do cartoons with acres of paper. I mean, so the source material became something that really spurred on artistic production. A lot of pigments still remained expensive. The fresco technique that he used goes back to antiquity, so there are a lot of traditional methods that he used. His greatest advances, I think, are in the field of architecture. But there again, he's using the elements of classical architecture in a completely free, new way, right. Expressive, personal, nervous, energetic, all these aspects of his personality show up in his architecture, which uses all the columns and bases and pediments and everything that you see everywhere, but in a completely new way, and with great freedom. And I think that freedom really is something that we identify closely with Michelangelo.
One of the great themes that he keeps returning to is this theme of the resurrection.
Yes.
Why do you think that is?
He was interested in the how the divine could be accessed in daily life, and he thought about his own weaknesses and his own limitations, and he's always struggling to finish works of marble, for instance, trying to find that core inside, that perfect figure that he just had to liberate from all that extra marble. So that the image of the resurrected Christ, or Christ in limbo, to him was a fascinating topic. You know, at this time there was an effort to try to bring Neoplatonism and Christianity together, and a lot of people saw them as being essentially about the same things, and sought to unite them and harmonize them. And Michelangelo was very much in those debates. He learned how to sculpt in the courtyard of the Medici around some of the greatest philosophers and theologians of his day that were brought there by the Medicis, and he could participate in their discussions. And so their musings were something that became a philosophy and a theology that really governed his life. And you see that exploration of Jesus, he identified very closely with Christ as someone who suffered and yet who was both God and man. In other words, who understood or had access to and was part of the Godhead. And I think this was, to him, was electrifying. And he tries to find ways on paper to show or to understand that, because drawing for him is about thinking and working out solutions. And that's why you see this wonderful image of the resurrection, where the feet that are touching the ground, they're still held to the earth, are shown in many different positions, because he's trying to find the right solution. And yet the farther up the figure you go, the more resolved it is. So you just can see those two natures in the same figure, and there are other puzzles like that too, like Christ in limbo, where again the suffering of Jesus is something that is felt at the same time as his power, or his divine powers, his ability to go into hell. And so these are all puzzles. He doesn't present one grand solution. He thinks about these things. They are figures for art. They're figures that were often used in painting, but he thinks about them in completely new ways, and how to picture that. And imagery to him is the way of thinking.
Next up, we take a look at Michelangelo's study for the risen Christ.
In this drawing, we see Michelangelo trying to solve a problem. We don't know what finished work of art this was made for. And it may have been even made as a composition to help out a friend. There's some suggestion that it's been found in a composition by an associate. But what he's trying to solve here is how to show the risen Christ. It's a subject that's fascinating for him, because he really tries to express his ideal, his Platonic ideal of perfection here. Here we see the feet of Christ as they're are sketched in many different positions on the tomb. So there is a kind of uncertainty and imperfection there, but the farther we get up the drawing, the more resolved the figure is with shading. So it's as if the body's becoming perfect the farther it is away from the earth, which is where death is. And the part below is just drawn with manic energy. It really looks very unresolved and very uncertain. So I think that's what makes the drawing especially beautiful. It's not just that he's expressing the struggle of trying to find that final position, a kind of philosophical struggle for him, almost a hypothetical one, but it's also that we get that philosophy expressed in the drawing. We don't know where the one ends and the other begins, but we do know that it's a drawing of striking and stirring spirituality, and I think that that's what's so remarkable about the sketch, because we don't know what the end in mind was. Almost all drawings for him were a tool of the trade, and most of them were for paintings or for architecture. So in other words, this is likely for a painting. But it shows him thinking and pondering the way he must have done every single day. We know he drew every day, and we have only a small fraction of the surviving drawings. But what we do have, it gives us a wonderful insight into the creative process of one of the greatest artists in the history of art.
The second half of our special feature on Michelangelo, Quest for Genius, continues our conversation with Lloyd DeWitt, Curator of European Art at the Art Gallery of Ontario. In part two, we'll talk about Michelangelo's enduring legacy and his influence on French sculptor Rodin.